Hey gang, we're going to start this special episode of VMTV with a road trip. Stephanie and I took a trip to Clifton, New Jersey to visit the Digital Press video game store. You'll see what the store looks like soon. For now, let's kick off our second retro gaming special with a little interview. Check it out. Hey gang, we are here at the Digital Press store in Clifton, New Jersey, and I'm sitting here talking with Joe Santulli. How are you doing today, Joe?
Good to see you, John.
Good to see you, too. We finally got an interview going, guys. So, why not start with the usual boring list of questions? But we'll move on to something more interesting a little later on. Don't change the channel. It's YouTube, anyway. How'd you get started? Let's start with that.
How did I get started?
How'd you get started with...
Gaming. And collecting.
In gaming and collecting.
So I would imagine you walk into a place like this and you're like, what the hell is this, right? Or you've seen the collections in the past and you're like, why would somebody go through this semi-hoarding sort of situation, right? And I think I probably start like any other hoarder does. Like I want that, and I now have to make sure that I have everything in between those things to make sure that it's a complete set, right? And then now that I finished that, what do I do next? It's a matter of like constantly completing and building on collections. And I did that all the time, the whole time I was a kid. I did it with comic books. I did it with stamps. I did it with coins for a while. I was into baseball cards. And then this video game thing came along, and it was something I connected to much better than any of those other things. And I just abandoned all other hobbies, and my buddy Kevin and I decided to start sort of being hoarders together. So we started this whole collecting thing, and Digital Press was formed in 1991 in an effort to sort of find out who else was out there doing what we were doing.
What did you first start collecting? We're talking like Atari 2600, ColecoVision, or something a little bit older like the Fairchild?
Yeah, I didn't own a Fairchild until much later. I was pretty much mainstream gaming. Kevin had the 2600. I had an Intellivision. Just in no time at all, we were both collecting for both systems. And then we just, from that point, it was everything. You know, we got to the point where we were like, well, looks like there's not going to be an Atari 2600 anymore. What are we going to do? You know, let's go back and see what systems we might have missed along the way. So it then becomes that matter of just backfilling everything that you've got.
And at one point, did you realize, like, hey, I should open up a store. I can make some money out of this.
I don't know about making money, but I decided to open this store in 2005, like probably really only months before I did it. It just seemed like something clicked. I had a buddy, my buddy Sean Kelly in Chicago, had been running a store for a couple of years. I had been to his place that fall prior, and he was saying to me, you should be doing this. He's like, I know you're not crazy about the job that you're in. I was corporate America type guy, desk job, 9 to 5, a lot of hours working for somebody else. And he was like, you know, this is what you should probably be doing, because if I can do it, you know, you've got all the inventory and sort of product knowledge to take it. So I pretty much just dropped what I was doing at the time and decided to jump in.
Judging from this collection, I imagine not all these games are yours. I'm pretty sure people have brought them in over the years and, you know, they didn't want them anymore or they didn't work. Do you guys have experience repairing video games or, you know, sending them to someone who can, you know, maybe get a 72-pin connector for the NES or fix, you know, the fuse on a Sega CD, anything like that? Are you guys equipped to handle that kind of situation?
I mean, to some degree, I think we do probably 80% of the game repairs that come in here we're able to manage. But inevitably, somebody will walk in like, my FM Marty Towns doesn't seem to be reading games properly. And it's like, well, you know, in order for me to do that, I would have to have another FM Marty Towns and the parts for it. And chances are that that's just not sitting around in the shop. So simple things like Nintendo's and Atari systems. We do scratch games that people bring in that don't work anymore. We fix those all day long for people. So we're constantly bringing systems and cartridges back from the dead. CDs are very easily repaired with a machine. And the rest of it is just a matter of how much you want to tinker with it. And, you know, generally, if you have a system that's almost working and one that's broken, you can get one that works.
Do you judge the price by the condition or you just go on price guides? You don't want to rip off your customers. Mm-hmm. You want them to get a good deal, but at the same time, you don't want to make them think, oh, $6.99 must be a, you know, crap game.
Yeah. I mean, there's an awful lot of data on the internet nowadays, right? So remember where we came from. Like, Digital Press started as this fanzine and gathering of collectors, but as we got enough expert collectors, we had enough people to be able to tell us what are things worth, what's really rare, what things are hard to find in different areas of the country or in other countries. And we got to the point where we were able to actually start putting books out. So we, I mean, I'm pretty sure we were the first people to put price guides for video games out.
Most likely, yes.
We probably were. So we were doing that for a long, long time. So stepping into this world was a little bit of that. You know, it was a little bit of, well, we have to use common sense. A lot of it is, how often do I see it for real? You know, how in demand is it? And then what condition is it in? And those are the same things that we use as our formula when we're pricing here.
You mentioned hoarders. That brings up an interesting question. What's your home collection like? Is it something that, you know, your wife will continue to support until you're in your 70s and 80s? Or is it something that along the line she's going to say, you got to get rid of this stuff, honey?
Well, we've been married for over 20 years, so we've been together a long time. And when we first went out looking for a home, she already knew what she was getting herself into, because the room that in my parents' house was like wall to wall, and every nook and cranny was filled with games. And when we moved, I made a deal with her. I'm like, we have to find a house where there's at least a little segment that we can carve out for my games. And in return, I promise you, I will never go outside of that boundary. That's going to be, you know, the limit to the collection.
I'll bet you lied.
Well, like I said to Stephanie, when you walk into my house, you would never know that a gamer lived there. The living room's normal, kitchen, there's no like hidden Mario things like salt shakers or anything. It's all a normal house. Bedrooms are normal. But when you go into the basement and you get to my collection, you all of a sudden are like, what is going on in this house? Like, it'll look like a completely different place. The lie is that I have somewhat hidden things in places.
Oh, so I was just about to say, you probably have like a secret panel behind the wall that's just like, I'll just move this wedding picture aside, open it up, like, here's my collection.
I've taken over spaces in the house that wouldn't have been used for anything else. I have taken wherever I could. But I've been there for 22 years. I think I'm allowed, you know, we weren't using the space under the bed. Can I just put a bin under there with things? Yeah, you know, I can get away with that. But to be honest with you, nowadays, my collection is, it's not even in my house. Like, maybe 25% of it is in my house. Most of it is either here or in Vegas in storage.
Tell us about the origins of Classic Gaming Expo, how it got started, and why.
Okay, so Classic Gaming Expo is actually an offshoot of the 1998 World of Atari. So, yeah, there was a one-year show that was done by John Hardy, Keita Aida, and some guy that I never actually met, who was actually sort of in charge. That guy wanted to do a show to make money. So they did that in Vegas the first year, and then the following year, John decided, I'm not working with that guy anymore. Let's do a whole gaming expo for Classic Gaming called Classic Gaming Expo in Vegas. So 99 was really the first year for that. In 99, I was a vendor. I was digital press, but I had already known those guys pretty well. Sean Kelly had joined him that year, and then Keita the following year went off to do, he worked for NVIDIA, so he went off to, you know, pursue very important career choices, and they needed somebody else, so they asked me in 2000 to join them. So from 2000 until 2012, we've done, I don't know, maybe 8 shows. We've missed a few years here and there. It's almost always in Vegas. We experimented a little bit with California, thinking Vegas is an island and maybe we're not getting local communities involved, so let's try this out here. So we did Burlingame one year, we did San Jose, and we didn't see any really big pickup in attendance or in anything for that matter, so we decided to come back to Vegas, which is where I'm sure we're going to run it for good, unless we open a museum somewhere else and we do it there.
Speaking of museum, tell us about the museum as well.
So Classic Gaming Expo is a bunch of different things. It includes vendors who sell all the old games, and then it includes arcade machines, which we've talked about. And there's keynote speeches from people that used to work in the industry or still do. And then there's this big section of CGE called the Classic Gaming Expo Museum. And this is where the three of us have a good portion of our collections on display. And that display, up until about a year ago, was really limited to that one show in Vegas. And, you know, we've been saying for a while, and we hear it from people all the time, why don't you guys get out to more shows and do this, or better still, why don't you just open a real place where we can go on any given day? And that kind of got us started. So this past year, we've spent a lot of time all over the country showing the stuff off and promoting a physical museum. We did a Kickstarter last year. That was pretty good. We've gotten some very interested parties and a lot of help from the industry to support our goals. And who knows, you know, maybe in a year from now, 2 years from now, we have an actual physical place. But that's the whole goal, is to find that place and settle in there and have that be the place where everybody can go, see everything that you saw when you were a kid, experience things that are considered vintage now, And be able to actually interact with it. You know, sometimes when I hear museum, I always think of this stuffy sort of, you know, look at that. Isn't that interesting? I wonder what he was thinking when he made that. I can't touch it. But, you know, we really want our museum to be something that is completely interactive as possible. Game controllers are there. You know, your choice of game systems and games that you want to play are all at your fingertips. I mean, there's an element of behind glass, but we really want the bulk of it to be something where you could go in and experience it. So let's say you're a 13-year-old kid now and you weren't around for the Atari 2600. We want to build an experience where you could walk in and that's what it was like. That's what it was like in 1977 when we got our first Atari 2600 console. You know, it looks like the living room that I was in. It looks like the TV. It doesn't look very high tech, but this is the way it felt. You know, we want to be able to recreate that for every one of those game consoles along the way.
So there's an event that takes place once a month here at this store, NAVA. What does NAVA stand for?
It's North Atlantic Video Game Aficionados. And I didn't make that up.
Who did?
Mike Etler. The gentleman started NAVA in, I believe, 1994 in his store in Howell, New Jersey. And he ran that there... for quite a few years. I think he finally closed his store, I want to say in 2002 or 2003. And so we went through a couple of years of not having such a thing or place to gather until I opened the store. And then I asked him, would you mind if we picked it up again since we have a store and a lot of the same people? And he blessed it. He came to the first one and a couple after that. But that's it. We just sort of picked up the ball and ran with it.
When people come to NAVA, what can they expect to find? There's tournaments that happen here, right?
I try to do a tournament at every NAVA. In fact, so I hate to make it back up like this, but digital press for many, many years was themed, right? We would put an issue out. It was a fanzine, right? So every 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, sometimes we would come up with a theme and all of the writers would all sort of try to get everything focused on that. So when I took over NAVA, I thought it would be kind of fun to try to keep that tradition going so that digital press was somehow tied in and made it a unique event for us. So... you know, I try to come up with a tournament, an arcade game for people to beat, and then we try to focus the games that are on free play as sort of, you know, representative of whatever that theme might be. So we, you know, the whole concept of NAVA is that we're going to find a theme for it, and we're going to try to build all of this stuff around it. So it's a tournament, it's an arcade challenge, it's free play on whatever consoles we have hooked up at the time. You know, it's a regular meeting where no matter what's going on, I can drop everything and just kind of hang out for a while. And whether I'm just playing, or I found some stuff at a flea market, a garage sale that I want to trade off, or I could find an owner for, or I just want to hang out and talk.
You're marooned on a desert island. You can only have one console, maybe about three games. Let's be realistic, because I know a lot of you are going to chime in and say, well, how are we going to get video games to work on a desert island? So let's rephrase the question. You're marooned on a desert island with the professor and frickin' Marianne. The professor made a generator out of coconuts. Now you can have your console and you can have your three fucking games.
And Marianne.
You could, yes. I'm sure she makes delicious daiquiris in her spare time. So what console, what three games would you have, and why?
One console, three games. Mm-hmm. I would have to have Adventure for the Atari 2600, so I guess I would have an Atari 2600.
Absolutely.
And then I would pick two other games that I've spent a lot of time on. I would probably pick by myself. Warlords wouldn't be all that great. I don't know. I guess I would probably take Star Raiders and River Raid. Those would be my... So that and Adventure.
Just remember, you're going to be marooned on this island, right, until someone comes and rescues,
right,
you.
Well, Adventure's random, right? So I can play it a million times, and it'll always be different. And Star Raiders gives the illusion of a giant space out there that does change each time you play it. So those would be great. And then River Raid, I've never gotten to the end of. So now all of a sudden, I would have a whole lot of time to get to that final bridge, wherever that might be.
One last question. Tell us about your collection of hats.
I don't know, I've worn baseball hats ever since I was a kid, and anytime I saw a video gaming hat come up, you know, like this one, I guess I'm wearing the 3DO Way of the Warrior hat, right? So on the 3DO Way of the Warrior game, which I loved, they had the little mailing card, and you got the pin and the hat, and, you know, this is an original. Same thing, I have a Mutant League football hat, which...
Nice.
Yeah, to be honest with you, I don't think I've ever seen that coupon since. Like, whatever it was that I mailed in to get it, I haven't seen the mail-in certificate. But I got that. I have a Virtual Boy hat when that came out, and just a bunch of stuff. I don't know. I've always picked them up when I could.
Joe, thank you so much for your time.
It's been fun.
It's been a real pleasure. And guys, come out to Clifton, New Jersey. You get to talk to Joe. You get to play some games, maybe buy a few, and get some free booze, too. We'll see you guys later. All right, retro game players, let's take a look at the Sega Genesis version of Ms. Pac-Man, released in 1991. This was actually put out by Tengen, as opposed to Namco usually handling anything related to our yellow eating machine and his significant other. Instead of just replaying the same old arcade mazes that we've memorized by heart during our time at Chuck E. Cheese, the Genesis version gives you all new mazes to run around in. So if you don't want to munch on power pellets and ghosts in your standard mazes, there are big mazes, strange mazes, and even mini mazes to choose from. All of them look great and they will pleasantly surprise any pack enthusiast. The game also gives you various options, including playing through the game with a second player, either cooperatively, competitively, or alternating. There's also a pack booster which speeds up Ms. Pac-Man. In many cases, you will need it. Could probably do without the speed lines whenever the booster is in use, though, but I get it. What else can I say about Ms. Pac-Man? The Genesis version has arcade-perfect graphics, the bigger mazes scroll very well, and the layout of the new mazes are excellent. Pac purists will dig the sound as well. It's roughly 95% close to the original machine, which used to eat up all of our quarters when we were younger. Now, personally, I found a slight issue with the control. Whether I was using the standard Genesis controller or even plugging in an Atari 2600 or 7800 joystick, there were a few times where I didn't mean to go in a certain direction and I met a ghostly fate at the hands of either Inky or Pinky. I think the overall controls are not 100% perfect. The new mazes, though, will certainly offer a terrific challenge. Even the mazes labeled strange are real funky looking, but they are loads of fun to go through. Now, I picked up Ms. Pac-Man on the Sega Genesis for about $5 or $6. I'm sure you can find it cheap enough if you shop around in the right places. This one is an absolute keeper. This one was requested by one of our fans for a long time. This is River City Ransom for the NES. This is an action role-playing beat-em-up. How often do you hear those words used together? In this game, it's up to Ryan and Alex to save Ryan's girlfriend from a dude named Slick. You'll butt heads with various gang members in order to rescue the girl. You can punch and kick to start with, but you can learn other techniques as you visit certain shops. If you've collected enough money from the thugs you've defeated, you can not only buy the books that will teach you these moves, but you can also buy food and other essentials during your fight. As with most beat-em-up titles, you'll clear the screen of enemies, move forward, fight more guys, move forward, repeat as necessary. Not too story-driven. When Stephanie and I tackled the two-player mode, the fun didn't really last for too long. I myself don't consider this to be a bad game. The graphics are pretty decent, featuring some cartoonish sprite animations. Nothing realistic, and what's funny is reading the bad guy's last words, either BARF or MAMA, should not be uttered by any real-life gang member, ever. But in an NES game, that's pretty damn funny. I did notice some slowdown during the two-player game, though, and yes, we were using an original River City Ransom cartridge on an actual NES. It could be just all the characters on screen all at the same time. There's a good chunk of music tracks to hear throughout the game, and they sound cool enough. There's also nice sound effects of you punching and kicking, as well as the effects of some of the weapons that you'll pick up along the way. The sound overall is decent enough. You won't really have much trouble moving your character around and performing his basic moves. However, the slowdown and the fact that you can hit the other player when you mean to hit your enemy can frustrate some players. Let's just say Steph and I spent most of our playing time apologizing to each other for accidental ass-kicking. River City Ransom isn't a lengthy game, unless you really suck at playing, then you'll be at the controls for a few hours. The game does offer you passwords to make the journey easier. If you don't own an original Nintendo Entertainment System, that's cool. If you spend time on the Wii's Virtual Console, I suggest you give this one a try and see what you think.
Hey buddy, I'm in Japan, I'm in Akihabara, and this is called Super Potato. It's a retro game store. Let's go see what they've got to offer.
Super Potato is in the heart of a place in Tokyo called Electric City or Electric Town. It's where all the electric stores are, where they sell everything from refrigerators to, here we are, games. And it's a place that I've frequented many times when I lived there. Every time I go back to Japan now, I make sure I spend some time, probably usually at least half a day or a whole day there, by myself wandering around the streets. And Super Potato here is an exceptionally awesome retro game store. As you can see from all these clips, they just jam every nook and cranny with retro gaming goodness. It's pretty safe to say that Super Potato probably contains almost anything under the sun when it comes to retro gaming. They have many, many obscure handhelds, as you're seeing here. Guidebooks galore, which I'm a whore for. I love guidebooks. I've got tons of Japanese guidebooks and American guidebooks, English guidebooks that I buy, but I don't even really look at. I just like them because it kind of completes my game for me. The prices of games at Super Potato are competitive to what you would find on eBay or Craigslist. Well, Craigslist, fuck Craigslist. But yeah, they know what they're doing here. It's not like they're just dumping shit into the shelves and pricing it way up or way down. Yeah, you'll get your ass ripped open easily if you're not careful here, because they are on top of their game. Retro game, that is.
Hey folks, it's Matt again in Akiba, and I just want to show you what I always have eaten when I come here by myself. Let's see what I always eat, okay? It's something you can buy on the street for about $5 or $6. So, I'm going to show you right here.
Okay, this is it. It's called the Doner Kebab. It's great. It goes great with Coke. Big can of Coke.
There's a lot of other stores here in Akiba that sell retro games. It's not just Super Potato. As I said earlier, I wander around half a day or a full day. I frequent many of the stores around there. Some are little mom-and-pop places, some are chain stores. They all offer gaming goodness, which is unrealized in most places in the U.S. You can't find this kind of place in the U.S. I love Japanese arcades. The cacophony of noise just blasts you into another dimension. The realm that you land up in is like this. There's lights, there's people, there's noise, people shuffling around, half drunk, who knows what they're on, and they're sitting at these machines doing all the shit that they love to do. Some of these people are here from dusk to dawn. In Japan, the machines are $1. You can't get a quarter here in Japan. They're 100 yen coins, and they pump these little puppies into these machines non-stop all day. And with that, I will bid you a fond adieu, and it's time for this Akiba adventurer to go to his capsule hotel and take a small respite. I will see you all next time on Videomasters TV. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Hey, you retro game nuts, got a few finds for the digital dig that are retro game themed, so check them out. First up is a funny NES Kung Fu parody video.
Boy, how I wish this was a real video game, as our hero Thomas dishes out punches, kicks, and sweet-ass moves that we only dream about doing in the original Nintendo cartridge. And just wait until you see all the crazy stuff that happens later on as the video progresses. I'm not going to spoil it all. Have a look for yourself later on. Now here's a game that you can play on your NES emulator of choice. This is called Mega Man Ultra, and it is a hacked version of Mega Man 2 with features that I didn't think were possible. I mean, are you seeing this massive Shy Guy, folks? That's straight out of Super Mario 2, for Christ's sake! And that's not all. A boss battle with Mauser from the same game? If you want to see more, as I do right now, I can certainly link you up. This looks exciting, my friends. Here's a website that was referred to me recently by Matt. It's called Local Melito. And these are game developers who seem to specialize in creating retro-style games. For instance, this game here kind of reminds me of Ghosts and Goblins on the NES. And here we have a version of Wolfenstein 3D called 8-Bit Killer. And this arcade-style game called Endless Forms Most Beautiful. Okay. These games look sweet, and you can obtain them from their website, which is www.localmelito.com. That'll wrap up this quickie digital dig, and we will conclude our retro gaming special part 2 right here. Thanks for joining us. Hope you've enjoyed this episode. We will see you all another time.